I am who I am in large part because of the Boys and Girls Club. I mean, the Boys and Girls Club helped create me. It helped me learn about life, helped me learn about myself.
All my ships came in at the Boys and Girls Club. Companionship, sportsmanship, you name it, scholarship.
I mean, the lessons that I learned from a young adult all the way through my career through the Boys and Girls Clubs is perseverance. You know, the Boys and Girls Club has taught me to never give up.
When I deal with people, I deal with them honestly, I deal with them with integrity. All those things were taught me here, and those things come back into play now as a professional.
I had my first opportunity to leave this state on a trip with Boys and Girls Club. First time I ever flew commercially was with Boys and Girls Club. First opportunity to ever get up in front of public and speak was with Boys and Girls Club. So Boys and Girls Club to me represents opportunity.
I've been with Boys and Girls Club of the Midlands for last 10 years, but I've been with Boys and Girls Clubs for 27 years. I started my career as a junior staff out in Minneapolis, Minnesota.
I started coming here in 1985. I was 9 years old, and the Boys and Girls Club began to impact my life at a very critical time, because at that time, my dad did what I call a Houdini. He disappeared, so it left a void in my life, and fortunately for me, the Boys and Girls Club was here to help meet that need.
My mom rarely let us leave the yard, let alone go somewhere where we had to walk a few miles to get there. And so when she learned more about the club and she got comfortable with it, she allowed me to come.
Funny enough, my mother had us in orchestra, and I was horrible. And I got this solo, and during the course of the solo, I didn't play. So it was just two or three bars of silence. And after it was over, I went to my mom and I said, "Mom, I'm terrible at this, and I want to play sports."
My brother actually started volunteering at the Boys and Girls Club first, and he just wanted to see how it was, and I tagged along, and it turned out to be a very fun experience.
We grew up in a single parent home, and one of the things that we enjoyed was going to Boys and Girls Club and doing a lot of recreational activities, and now that we are here in South Carolina giving back, we're still involved with recreational.
We didn't have anything else to do. We was out in the street getting in trouble, so somebody guided us over there to that direction.
And we were always very active young people. It was like the cat in the hat when the kids were sitting there upset because it was raining out. We didn't have the kind of technology kids have today, so to have fun, you wanted to be outdoors or in the Boys and Girls Club having fun.
When I first came into the club, I just saw a bunch of kids running around, and I did not know what to think. But a little girl came up to me named Mia, and she treated me like an older sister, and she really got me into touch with the Boys and Girls Club and showed me how wonderful a place it was.
Well, when I walked in this place, I saw the pool, ping pong, air hockey. I had never been exposed to anything like that.
A room full of games, a room full of other kids, and the balls bouncing in the gymnasium. It was nothing like we'd ever seen, because we'd always played basketball in dirt fields or on asphalt courts and that sort of thing. So it was a brand new world for us, and it was an inviting world and one that proved to be real good for us.
And the games were great, but that's not what kept me coming back. It was the fellowship with other members, but especially the staff at the Boys and Girls Club, and specifically David Campbell, who was my unit director at the time. For me, he was my Coach Carter, my Joe Clark, my Jaime Escalante. It was him I'd run after school to hear and say, "Hey, here's my report card," or, "I had this conversation with this girl today. What do you think?"
Oh, who's in charge, you or him?
Typical day when you got here, it was knock your homework out as quick as you can so you can get to the games, the gym.
I help the kids with their homework, and I help them with activities, and I constantly throughout the day, I tell them different information, different facts, and they actually love it so much. You wouldn't think that kids would like learning, but they do.
You know, one of the things that we try to teach all of our kids is, again, one, get along with others, look like you, don't look like you, take pride in who you are, celebrate the important things about you and others, but to also give back to the community.
My coach, Rich Grabish, and he passed away while I was in Iraq, but what he would do is if we ran well, he would take us to a restaurant. And he would order the food and we would have to try it. So the lady says, you know, how would you like your steak? And I said, oh, well done. He gets up. He says, if you're gonna insult the chef, we're leaving. He says, you never get a filet mignon more than medium.
You know, when you went to the club, there were people who always reminded you of your potential. We grew up saying, use basketball, don't let basketball use you. You learn camaraderie among others. So I could say that when we started to discover our strengths and talent in basketball, that took us from being ugly ducklings to beautiful swans. That was a defining moment.
I couldn't put it into one specific event, but the experience is really what has shaped me today. I mean, we traveled all over. We flew on a People's Express out to Nebraska and competed out there in Nebraska. And then the very next week we turned around and somebody had donated a van and we drove out to St. Louis and competed in St. Louis. We went all over.
I met Nikki Haley. It was an honor just to be a part of history. That was South Carolina's first female governor. And for me to have the opportunity to meet her, it was rewarding. I was flattered. I was shocked.
Again, you have people who saw your potential, and so they instilled discipline, repetition and doing things the right way, the challenges of reaching, you know, goals.
You know, they showed you how to be able to compete against one another and still understand that it's just all a sport.
There have been kids who were shy and quiet and they become outgoing. There are kids who used to be the worst kids in the club and they used to act up so much and they became our superstar students. And so throughout the whole process of the Boys and Girls Club, when the kids first enter at the beginning of the school year, I guarantee you at the end of the school year, they'll be a whole new person.
If you think about athletes like Michael Jordan or Muhammad Ali, they don't say they were excellent athletes, they say they were the greatest. And the Boys and Girls Club is really where you can learn to be great at whatever it is you decide to do.
I have this theory when I speak to young people is, if you're gonna sweep the floor, be the best floor sweeper you can be. You know, be great at it, anything that you do. And I believe that's what the Boys and Girls Club is all about.
Be great means be the best that you can be. Be yourself. Be expressive. If you are a musician and music is your talent, stick with it and see where it takes you.
When you start telling kids over and over again anything, if you tell them they can't be anything, they won't be anything. But if you tell them to be great and they hear it over and over, then their focus will be on being great.
How did she get this?
The Youth of the Year honor is the beginning of the path. That's a responsibility because now you have to do things. And all of us, you know, when we're members of an organization, we have a responsibility to represent that organization now and also in the future.
Back in 1980, eons ago, I was Youth of the Year. To be Youth of the Year means that you're not only just a member, but you're a volunteer, you're a leader, you're displaying a lot of the principles that you've learned. The idea is to encourage them, pat them on the back, and at the same time, hold them up as an example of this is what you can be for the other young people.
Both Terry and Perry have been absolutely exceptional in not only celebrating who they are and taking great pride in both, you know, how their athletic careers, but, you know, now in coaching. They're both coaches in the high school level and helping develop young men and young women into young adults.
To me, what's interesting about the Dozier brothers is they're also from Maryland. And they went to school right around the corner from where I was. Now, they're a little older. But I think what's interesting about that is you have three guys who did very well in sports who have the most important thing that we have in common is that we participated in Boys and Girls Club, and now here we are.
I didn't know how to feel about it because I always thought of Hall of Fame as being old, so I refused to be old, but I just think it's an honor. I mean, it's a tribute when you're being nominated for anything on that caliber, that means you've done a lot. And that's on academically as well as being able to socially be able to contribute back to the community. But I think just the fact that somebody acknowledged you of being of that high of a statue, and I think that's just an honor by itself.
So Chantel is the 2012-2013 Youth of the Year for the Boys Council of the Midlands, and is a phenomenal story. And so Chantel hasn't always fit in with her peers, and has gone through a great deal of teasing and in many cases bullying, and has overcome that in part through working with the kids at the Boys and Girls Club.
For many years, I've been bullied. I've been teased because kids told me that I was fat, I was ugly, I talked funny, and I really couldn't become anything in life. And through the Boys and Girls Club, I have learned that I'm not this fat, ugly girl that they told me I was. Mm-hmm. I was something more, and I was really someone that the kids needed. And for so long, I was ashamed of being myself, but the kids and the staff, they taught me that I am perfect the way I am, and they needed me to be me.
In her interview, she said this, which really stuck in my heart. She said, "The Boys and Girls Club saved my life." And that's a phenomenal impact. And in a lot of ways, it did the same for me. I too was awarded South Carolina State Youth of the Year in 1989. It was a tremendous accomplishment. And even at that time, I didn't really understand the levity of it. But looking back years later, I see how much it meant and how important that award was.
When I first got the news, my trainer, Miss Terry, she had called me. It was like 6 o'clock in the morning. I was still very tired and I was very sleepy. She had called me and she was like, "Congratulations." I was like, "For Youth of the Year." I was like, "Oh my gosh." I was so happy.
My boss came out, my parents came out, they had balloons, and my campus director was holding the balloons. And my kids started singing "Happy Birthday." I didn't know whose birthday it was, I didn't know what was going on, until I turned around and I saw that they said that I won. Oh, tears of joy, I was just happy, and my kids were happy for me.
Well, the first thing I'm gonna do is go get a t-shirt, put it on my back, and let everybody know.
I want to wear the check. No, just you like to be associated with good and great people. And not only that, when you can't play ball anymore, you get older, your body don't respond like it used to, it's nice to be remembered.
It's not because we've done something that's so great, but it's because we are examples of what can happen when people take interest in you and give you an opportunity, give you an outlet.
It's an honor. And the responsibility that it comes with is to give back and to mentor. The question really is, what does it mean to be in a group of people who have accomplished the things that they've accomplished? And to look at that list, you know, the guys like Ty Corbin, guys like Randy Scott, you know, the Dozers. You know, when you go down that list and you look at all these people that are in the Midlands that are doing great things, It's an honor for me to be in the list, but when you look at that list, it's incredible what the Boys and Girls Club can do.
My journey as Youth of the Year isn't over, but I hope that by becoming Youth of the Year, I can show others out there that who've been through my struggle, because I know that my message is going to be displayed for everyone to see, and my story and my struggle and how other people who have been through these things, they know that it's not the end and they can become more.
I mean, Boys and Girls Club of the Midlands has been involved in this community for over 50 years. Boys and Girls Club of America has been involved in the country for over 100 years. About 5 years ago, we took the approach that our services, every child deserves the Boys and Girls Club experience. And it's good for not just low-income kids, it's good for not just kids who are at risk, but it's good for all kids.
Well, the Boys and Girls Club has always boasted as being the most inclusive club in town. So if we're truly going to be inclusive, then we have to reach out to everyone and expand our coast.
And what we have found is that because a family comes from a high-income community or middle-income community, does not necessarily mean they're getting those basic skills that the Boys and Girls Clubs will teach.
I mean, how can anybody lose by mentoring children? And kids don't understand what those artificial barriers are that we place in the community. They don't understand those things. What they understand is learning how to do well, learning to be on time, learning to respect others, learning how to compete and be a good sport. Those things only can serve to better any community in which the Boys and Girls Club would choose to operate. And I would say to you that when you look at that list of people that have been helped by the Boys and Girls Club, you wouldn't be able to tell who was underprivileged and who wasn't. All you would see is successful people.
Every child deserves the life lessons that a Boys and Girls Club teaches. Every child needs to learn how to get along with others, how to feel good about themselves, how to set goals, to value education. Those fundamental skills that help all of us in life, they need to be taught. And not every child is getting that, regardless of where they live.
You know, Boys and Girls Club has been around for a long time. And I think the conception is for kids who maybe just who's struggling. And there are a lot of kids who are struggling and may not be financially, but just spiritually, mentally, you know, having mental guidance. So I think it definitely need to branch out. They've been around, they show a great reputation. And I think we need to get a little bit bigger.
Also, we got to adjust with the times. All of us do. You know, it's a new day. Kids learn a lot faster. They're in touch with the world now through the technology.
We're very proud to be right now at 45 locations, 3,000 kids, national accreditation. We are one of the biggest, if not the biggest, in the country. And we're certainly one of the best, if not the best in the country as well. And we're very proud of that. But I think we're just getting going. I think this is just the beginning of what the next phase is not 45 clubs, but 90 clubs. And how does that work? And how many more kids can we serve, and how quickly can we do it? That's the challenge that's in front of us.
My future with the club, I can see myself being campus director or still having ties with board of directors, or you know, still having that, oh, she was 2012 Youth of the Year, so coming to me for advice or mentoring skills. I'm not sure exactly if I'll have an exact position, but I'll definitely keep volunteering and staying with Boys and Girls Club.
When it comes to the Boys and Girls Club, I can easily put my stamp of approval on it because it was tried and true in my life and in the lives of a lot of my friends growing up, because we could have ended up anywhere. We could have ended up crawling through someone's window or kicking someone's door in, but because we had a positive place to go, and it was an accepting place, and it's still true today.
I owe my career to Boys and Girls Clubs. My first speaking engagement was provided by the Boys and Girls Club. I spoke in front of a bunch of board members, and so all I had to do was get up and say, hey, this is what my Boys and Girls Club means to me. And in a lot of ways, that launched my speaking career.
I thank the Boys and Girls Club for what they've done for me. My coach, Rich Gravish, I think about him every day.
When you have received so much as a youngster, when you grow up, you don't go away from those things. You just realize you have to contribute by giving back.
Mm-hmm. Youth of the Year, I feel like I'm gonna stay with Boys and Girls Club forever, which is a good thing, which is a good experience.
I still plan on volunteering at the Boys and Girls Club. And, well, I don't necessarily have to work there, but I would still love to volunteer there and help out the children.